Good morning, everybody. And to remember his many, many baptismal blessings is a good day. We all gather with a variety of problems, worries, regrets weighing on us. And so we come together, independent, but also united in that we come to a God who is just, who is mighty, who is good, who also is merciful, and he gives us grace by the blood of Jesus Christ. He gives us his Spirit. Today is Holy Trinity Sunday, a chance to reflect on that word Trinity as the best descriptor that we have of what God has revealed to us concerning who he is. Today, we're dressed in red, and we have the altar paraments adorned in red instead of the normal white, because it's also confirmation day for three of the daughters of our congregation who are rejoicing in their baptisms today and giving testimony that they have learned of this Jesus, this God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, who has made them, redeemed them, and who is sanctifying them. And they rejoice in that identity to be a child of God. So we rejoice with them. Since it is Trinity Sunday, it also is a chance for us to reaffirm our baptismal vows. We who were baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, to be able to join the Christians of old in saying, yes, I have been blessed by this God, I have been saved by this God, and I rejoice to continue living in faith and living in service to God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Please stand and turn to hymn 905. We'll sing verses 1 through 3, and we'll face the cross as it processes forward today. We have a procession of the cross and the torches that will light the altar candles, but also our confirmands, each carrying a symbol that stands for the means of grace, the Bible for the Word of God, the shell that reminds us of holy baptism, and also the chalice that reminds us of the Lord's Supper. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Before we begin on page 3 of our bulletin with the adoration, I'll mention that our service today includes our confirmands reading essays that they composed that reflect an aspect of their confirmation program learning. As we study, as we come to know God, we learn the Ten Commandments. Generally, our world has the law written on their hearts, whether they know God or not. So as an entry point, that's a beginning. And then the creed, as we learn the God who created, God who redeemed, God who sanctifies. And then we learn about prayer, the ways we engage with God, the means of grace where he brings forgiveness to us and he makes himself present with us. And so we will soon hear from each of our confirmands an aspect of their learning and their faith. So we begin with our adoration. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. On your wondrous works I will meditate.
And I will declare your greatness.
Alleluia. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts.
The Lord is full of his glory.
Alleluia. Please be seated.
Confirmation class, we learned about baptism. Growing up, we learned that we were saved when we were very little by being baptized. Baptism, however, doesn't mean that by the waters we are saved, but by the word of Jesus who washes us, gives us his name, and forgives our sins by taking them to himself on the cross as we are baptized. Matthew 28:19 says, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. By combining God's word with the water, he makes us his children and his disciples. When we are baptized, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. This shows us that we are baptized by God. By God baptizing us with his name, we become his adopted children and are saved by him. Some people think that if you are baptized in certain waters, you will be more saved. It isn't the type of waters that matters, but only Jesus. Ephesians 5:25-36 says, Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by washing of the water with the word. Jesus uses his word to do his divine work. Remember that Jesus said to baptize all nations, meaning it doesn't matter the age, the sex, or the race, or the background of a person, no matter what the circumstances. It is important for everyone to be baptized. We are saved by grace through the faith in Jesus, even if we cannot be baptized. But Jesus wants everyone to be baptized. Whether you are being baptized in a religious setting, or if there is an emergency and it takes place somewhere else, what is important is that Jesus is working through his word with the water. So long as you're baptizing or being baptized in the name of the Father and the Son of the Holy Spirit, you will become a child of God and therefore saved by him.
Thank you. Thank you, Mia. I think Mia's my goddaughter, so it's the first godchild that I'm officiating a confirmation for. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven. I said, I will confess my transgression unto the Lord. Let's take a moment to consider our lives and confess in silent prayer our sins to God our Father. O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities with which I have ever offended you and justly deserved your present and
thy heart is sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I have prayed to you with my mercy.
And for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor, sinful being. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all of your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I forgive you your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
One in three, give him all praises. sovereign majesty may be in glory seen, and to eternity love and adore.
Amen. We continue with Zoey's essay.
John chapter 8:12, when Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. I think thus of a song, this little light of mine. My candle will always be lit, because Jesus will always be with me. When Jesus comes again, he will take me with him. Until Jesus comes, I remember him during confirmation, the body and blood of Jesus Christ. I will remember to love Jesus, my parents, my friends, and neighbors. Not to take anything that is not mine. Don't tell lies or hurt anyone. I am precious in God's heart. God takes care of me and gives me what I need. Jesus loves us all.
Amen. Amen. I've been here at Zion long enough now that someone that I baptized is being confirmed. I remember that day right over there. Thank you, Zoey. Let us pray. Almighty God, our Father, dwelling in majesty and filling creation with your Spirit, reveal your glory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Cleanse us from doubt and fear, and send us boldly into all the world to worship you with your Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, living and reigning now and forever. Amen. We continue with our scripture lessons for this Trinity Sunday.
Our Old Testament reading is from Genesis chapter 1, verse 1 through chapter 2, verse 4. The account of creation. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, "Let there be an expanse in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters." And God made the expanse and separated the waters that were under the expanse from the waters that were above the expanse. And it was so. And God called the expanse heaven. And there was evening, and there was morning, the second day. And God said, "Let the waters under the heavens be gathered together in one place, and let the dry land appear." And it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called seas. And God saw that it was good. And God said, "Let the earth sprout vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees bearing fruit in which is in their seed, each according to its kind on the earth." And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed according to their own kinds, and trees bearing fruit in which is their seed, each according to its kind. And God saw that it was good, and there was evening and there was morning, the third day. And God said, "Let there be lights in the expanse of the heavens to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years, and let them be lights in the expanse of the heavens to give light upon the earth." And it was so. And God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day, and the lesser light to rule the night and the stars. and God set them in the expanse of the heavens to give light on the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fourth day. And God said, let the waters swarm with swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the expanse of the heavens. So God created the great sea creatures and every living creature that moves, with which the waters swarm, according to their kinds, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And God blessed them, saying, be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters in the seas, and let birds multiply on the earth. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, let the earth bring forth living creatures according to their kinds, livestock and creeping things, and beasts of the earth according to their kinds. And it was so. And God made the beasts of the earth according to their kinds, and the livestock according to their kinds, and everything that creeps on the ground according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over the livestock, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God he created him. Male and female he created them. And God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over every living thing that moves on the earth. And God said, behold, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is on the face of all the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the heavens, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has the breath of life, I have given every green plant for food. And it was so. And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. And on the seventh day God finished his work that he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work that he had done. So God blessed the seventh day and made it holy, because on it God rested from all his work that he had done in creation. These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. We sing together Psalm 8. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouth of babes and infants, you have established strength because of your foes, to still the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place. What is man that you are mindful of him, and the son of man that you care for him? Yet you have made him a little lower than the heavenly beings, and crowned him with glory and honor. You have given him dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, and also the beasts of the field, the birds of the heavens and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the seas. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
Our second reading comes from Acts chapter 2, verses 14 and 22 to 36, the sermon of Peter at Pentecost. Peter, standing with the 11, lifted up his voice and addressed them. Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God, with mighty works and wonders and signs that God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves know. This Jesus, delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men. God raised him up, loosing the pangs of death, because it was not possible for him to be held by it. For David says concerning him, I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand that I may not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad, and my tongue rejoiced. My flesh also will dwell in hope. For you will not abandon my soul to Hades, or let your Holy One see corruption. You have made known to me the paths of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence. Brothers, I may say to you with confidence about the patriarch David that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Being therefore a prophet, and knowing that God had sworn with an oath to him that he would set one of his descendants on his throne, he foresaw and spoke about the resurrection of the Christ, that he was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh see corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and of that we are all witnesses. Being therefore exalted at the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured out from this that you yourselves are seeing and hearing. For David did not ascend into the heavens, but he himself says, The Lord said to my Lord, Sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. Let all the house of Israel therefore know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please stand. Alleluia! Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. Alleluia! The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 28th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him. But some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always, to the end of the age. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Lord.
Please be seated. We sing hymn 876, verses 1 through 5. O blessed Holy Trinity, divine eternal unity, O Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, this day your name be uppermost. My soul and body keep from harm, and over all extend your arm. Let Satan cause me no distress, nor bring me shame and wretchedness. The Father's love shield me this day, the Son's pure wisdom cheer my way, the Holy Spirit's joy and light drive from my heart the shades of night. My Maker, hold me in your hand, O Christ forgiven.
Your
God's grace and peace to you. Grace and peace from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Today's Holy Trinity Sunday, a chance to marvel at the mystery of God. When Moses asked the presence that was burning in this bush in the desert, directing him to Egypt in an act of defiance against a superpower, Moses asked, "Who do I say you are? What is your name?" And the response of God was, "I am that I am. I am." God is who he is, regardless of how much we know or understand of him. But praise be to God that he reveals so much of himself in the things that he has made, the creation that declares the glory of God, the stars and the galaxies as we can now view in lenses that we've sent up into space, the majestic glory of a creation that can't exist unless something that's outside of time, matter, and space would set it into motion. So today in Holy Trinity Sunday, we read from Genesis 1, the account of creation, where you hear, you see God speaking into existence with the word, each component of what we take for granted every day. All the things that are so natural to us are so miraculous when you think of it. Biology, chemistry, physics, all these sciences give opportunity to marvel at what is. And the more that we've learned since the time of Darwin, especially, where they had such a simple assumption of the basic components of existence, of life, the things we've learned, the places we've viewed, in the microscopic to the macro, leaves us in awe. That God would say, "I am that I am," well, we get it. You don't need to explain it, because how could we understand it? In Psalm 8, "How majestic is your name in all the earth. And who are we that you would care anything about us in comparison to the marvel of the power of the sun, the intricacy and the wonder of forces that we can't explain, like gravity. We can measure it, we can observe it, but we can't explain it." Genesis 1 lets us know that God, in the beginning, said, "Let there be light." The Spirit of the Lord, the Spirit of God, hovered over the face of the waters. There we have God, and we have the Word that is spoken, and we have the Spirit all present. God was all in from the beginning. John tells us that the Word was with God, the Word was God, the Word became flesh. All things were made through this Word that was God, that was with God. We hear these words, we say, okay, the Word became flesh. Now we start to get it. Okay, Jesus, we have seen his glory. The eyewitnesses of Jesus said. St. Peter said, it's not cleverly devised myths or ideas that we've put forth, but we saw Jesus shining like a brilliant sun on the mountain with Moses and Elijah on that Mount Transfiguration day. When Jesus arose, it was undeniable that what he said was worth listening to. And there we have further revealing of God, of who he is. Where Jesus said, pray like this, "Our Father in heaven, holy be your name." Jesus said, "It's better for me to go so that the Holy Spirit will come." And he breathed and gave the Holy Spirit to his disciples. And we read today at the end of Matthew chapter 8, this commission that we call the Great Commission, these words of Jesus to his followers. And it's interesting, they go up to the mountain where Jesus has said, "Meet me there, let's go up to the mountain." And it says, even then, some doubted. But even though there was doubt, which you wonder, he doesn't explain that, but like, here is Jesus, and he is going to be king. What's going on? Father, Son, Holy Spirit, King, eternal kingdom. We've seen kings, they've ruled, they've had armies, they've had right-hand men in a capital city, and they've taken over territory, and they've put down their enemies, and they've created laws, and they've rewarded those allies. I don't get this Jesus who's like, he's risen, but here we go up a mountain, and he says, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey all the things I've commanded. And he gives this promise, surely I am with you. Lo, I am with you to the very end of the age. It's not too long after that that then he ascends and he's taken from their view. And the angels say, why are you staring up at the sky? He will come as he's departed. And such began the mission of the church. With wonders and doubts and confusion, to revere the God who displays his glory with the stars and the planets and the wonder of nature and the wonder just to be alive, to revere this God who also made clear through Christ that he is merciful and just. And if they had any trouble believing it, though they may not comprehend it, they might apprehend it by the power of the Holy Spirit to live in it. The mission of the church then was to live a life of discipleship, a life that navigated the world's troubles, but with faith. Navigate the enemies of God, those who hated God, but with faith and with the words of Jesus resonating in their ears, to love your enemies, to do good to those who persecute you, to be ready for his return. Will the Son of Man find faith when he returns? Was one of Christ's parables and questions. The answer is yes, because God is who he is, and he works how he works. And we thank the Lord that he's not only mighty and just, but Scripture tells us that God is love. God is love. Smart theologians have wondered about the Trinity, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, three persons in one Godhead, the same substance. One divine majesty. I've wondered at this, but one beautiful theory, one beautiful thought is that by being three and one, there is perfect unity and also capacity for true love. Because for love to exist, there is the beloved, in addition to the lover. For love of self is not love, but love of another, of care for another, of honor to another, submission to another, for the good of each other. This is love, as love is most clearly shown in Jesus giving his life on the cross for people who are yet dead in their defiance and rebellion, their sin. This is the greatest love, that's Jesus on the cross. That in the Trinity there is capacity without any creation, outside of space, matter, and time, there would be capacity for love to exist. And well, we have love and we have a sense of love because God is love and he created all things, and when he created them all, he created them just as he wanted, and he declared it with man and woman in his own image, very good. Very good. We spend our lives discovering life, discovering love. When we're born, we are confused and so limited in our understanding, and yet we cry out. And Jesus says that we have that faith like a child is what we all would have with God to be in His kingdom, that crying out for warmth, that crying out for food, that hunger that then is provided by some entity outside of his or herself. We're born in this need for another, and what a beautiful blessing it is to deliver not only the child, but to deliver that care and love, whether it's the parent or an adopted parent or anyone who is in that calling, that vocation of caring for the new life. But we grow up and we're longing for love. We have in this brokenness with the deceptions of Satan and our broken world, our broken flesh, all these messages concerning love, and yet God knows clearly that though so often we have gone astray, He knows so clearly the names of His beloved. And that's you, and that's me, and that's all people, all humanity, every tribe, every nation, every status of life, every category of closeness to God or distance from God. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever would believe in Him would not perish, but have everlasting life. It's for love is the motivation. And then in confirmation, we talk about how no one can say Jesus is Lord. Those words of faith, no one can declare it unless by the Holy Spirit. God is all in, not only in creation, but in a new creation. A making His family anew. With redemption in Jesus and the faith that the Holy Spirit brings as we hear of Him and the life that we now live. Empowered by the Holy Spirit, united by Christ and in Christ with Him and with each other, rejoicing in not only the open ear of God the Father as we pray, but the active provision of our Heavenly Father through a creation that still works, sufficient to keep us alive, and through means such as government to put down what is evil and to promote what is good, that we would be a people of peace, to live life, to know Him to the extent that He makes that possible, makes Himself knowable. And especially is our joy today as we gather to know peace and to know love, to know it and to share it, to make it known. Confirmation Day is a day to acknowledge that there are many things that we don't know, and yet here we are. We exist, and that's a miracle, a wonder. To be created in the image of God is a wonder that you should know and rejoice in, that I was born. That means I exist. That means that even if my past is all mixed up and my journey into the future is filled with questions and with struggle, I am created in the image of God, redeemed to live forever as a gift of God through Jesus Christ. And I'm not alone in the questions. I'm not alone in the living, the mission, the purpose of life. The Holy Spirit is mine. Confirmation Day is a day to rejoice. That I was baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. This God, this person, mysterious and wondrous as He is, I've been given His name. I've been adopted into His family. He has a home eternally for me. He keeps His promises foretold by the prophets. He keeps His promises displayed in the life and the victory of Jesus Christ. He keeps His promise still today as I wake up each day believing my sins are forgiven. The Spirit is with me. And I show the love of God in my living and my doing. Confirmation Day is more than a church service. It's waking up every day, wondering at this gift of who we are, wondering at God's will for my day, and maybe facing evils, but seeking God's will seeking his spirit to help, facing temptations, facing enemies who would seek to undermine God's joy and purpose in our life. On this Trinity Sunday, it's worth speaking a little bit as an example of a confirmation day, more of a confirmation life of a famous Christian who's come before us. We know some of his story because he wrote about it in his confessions. And this is Saint Patrick. Anybody hear of Saint Patrick ever? He didn't hang out with leprechauns that we know. He was born to a Christian family in the part of Europe, now known as Britain. In those days, it was part of the Roman Empire. And it was a turbulent time on the borders of the Roman Empire, and raiders from Ireland had come and they seized him. They were looting the seashores and going from community to community and community, wreaking havoc. They robbed Britain of young Patrick, took him to Ireland and enslaved him. And he was there for a number of years, but God was with him. And he was inspired to flee slavery, to run away, when he had a dream one day, and he made his escape, made it to the shore. Sailors kind of bargained, saying, hey, do these demeaning, debaseful things, and we'll give you free passage away from here. He said, no. And yet, with time, they still provided him escape, and he made it eventually to France, where he became a monk, where he became a priest, and then eventually he became a bishop. In a century, this is in the late 300s, in a century where Christianity earlier in 325 had been rocked in controversy because a very charismatic preacher in northern Africa had started saying, Jesus isn't God. Jesus wasn't in the beginning. And people were being swayed into this strange teaching that is embroiled in the question of Trinity. But in Nicaea, the church had gathered to consider the teachings of the apostles, to consider the revelation of Scripture, and to declare with the Nicene Creed that Jesus is God. There is one God in three persons, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. And Patrick was such a proponent of the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, he returned to Ireland. He returned to the place that had enslaved him as a child, that had, in a culture that was terrible, sought to demean him in exchange for freedom. He returned to Ireland because he knew there in all the world was a people who needed the truth of God, who needed to know the Creator, who is just, who does not look lightly on evil and sin, but who comes with forgiveness and redemption by the blood of Jesus. A people who needed the Holy Spirit, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, one God, to transform their world, transform their life. And he shared that good news from region to region to region to region. And people came to faith in God. A young man who was raised in the faith, who had all excuse and reason to walk away from God, from the tragic and the terribleness of what was inflicted upon him, but yet was restored and consoled and built up in the reality of the great I Am, his truth, his goodness, his justice, and his mercy. He shared the faith. The three-leaf clover is famous as a symbol of Ireland, right? It's green. But of St. Patrick as a symbol of the Trinity. There is no perfect way to explain the Trinity because we don't have anything in nature that God created that would perfectly embody the Trinity. We have things that we wonder about as Christ, before he was crucified, prayed to the Father, praying that we would be one even as they are one, a unity in diversity that we can only wonder about. But we rejoice that God is who he is, and that he has brought new hope and new life and forgiveness and joy to generation after generation. He also calls us to live in the redemption, to be baptized into his triune name, to have his Holy Spirit, and to do the loving things that are so hard to do often but are shocking to the world, because only the Holy Spirit would empower that good in our lives. I'd like to invite you to open your hymnals. We're not going to sing it, but this is a hymn that's attributed to St. Patrick. Right here in our repertoire of worship, number 604 in our Lutheran service books. These words, for us, can, as we read them together, these words can serve as a renewal of our confirmation joy today as a full congregation, people of God, as we accept Jesus, as we accept God, his revelation of who he is as it is, and rejoice in the help and joy and redemption that it brings to us. Number 604, verse 1 starts at the top. And then the first line will then jump to the first line of the next. And then when we get to the bottom of the page, the little instruction says, repeat after the first stanza only. So we then immediately at the bottom of this first page go back to the top for verse 2. Then when we get to that same spot at the bottom of the page, we'll go to the next page for verse 2. And then verse 3 is 2 pages, 4 and 5. We won't, I know some of you are sad about this, maybe we'll pick a different Sunday. We won't be reading the Athanasian Creed today, which I thought about weaving into all of this, but I suspected that you might invite some Irish raiders to come and snatch me away and take me to Ireland if we went 3 hours in the service. Although 3 is a good number, right? But we will read this entire psalm, remarking at the faith of an ancient believer, Patrick. I pray that this truth will influence you next March when St. Patrick's Day comes around, not to just imbibe of green beverages and be raucous with sports, but to rejoice in the Holy Trinity then, even as we rejoice today. We all ready? Verse 1, hymn 604. When it says, I bind, it means I make it my own. I live in it. I rejoice in it. It is my identity. It is my guide. I bind unto myself. We say, I bind unto myself today the strong name of the Trinity by invocation of the same, the three in one and one in three to the top. I bind this day to me forever, by power of faith, Christ's incarnation, his baptism in the Jordan River, his cross of death for my salvation. Next page. His bursting from the spiced tomb, his riding up the heavenly way, his coming at the day of doom. I bind unto myself today. Verse 3. I bind unto myself today the power of God to hold and lead, his eye to watch, his might to stay, his ear to hearken to my need, the wisdom of my God to teach, his hand to guide, his shield to ward, the word of God to give me speech, his heavenly host to be my guard. Verse 3. I bind unto myself today the power of God to hold and lead, his eye to watch, his might to stay, his ear to hearken to my need. I'm all confused. The wisdom, verse 3. The wisdom of my God to teach, his hand to guide, his shield to ward, the word of God, his heavenly host to be my guard. And now verse 4. Against the demon snares of sin, the vice that gives temptation force, the natural lusts that war within, the hostile foes that mar my course. Verse 4. Or few or many, far or nigh, in every place, in all hours, against their fierce hostility, I bind to me those holy powers. Verse 5. I bind unto myself the name, the strong name of the Trinity, by invocation of the same, the three in one, and one in three, of whom all nature has creation, eternal Father, Spirit, Word. Praise to the Lord of my salvation. Salvation is of Christ the Lord, God who created you. God who by the blood of his Son Jesus Christ redeemed you. God who in the waters of holy baptism sanctified you to be his temple. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, keep you in his joy, keep you in his grace, keep you in his mission, like Patrick, but like you, in his particular joy, in his particular work, keep you to the very end of the age in his faith. Amen. We continue with the offering of the church, an anthem prepared by David, a chance to pray and reflect on those who have passed the faith to us and say, thank you, Lord, that they offered their lives, their time, their words, their faith, their material goods, that we would know the one true God, and we consider God's calling also to us in time, talent, and treasure. Please stand. We sing our offertory on page 8. Take.
Prayer is something good to pray. As a Christian, I have recited this prayer countless times, both in church and in my personal prayer time. Its impact on my life and my understanding of God is very important. The prayer begins with the words, "Our Father, who art in heaven." This reminds me that God is not only a powerful and majestic being, but also a father who cares for me and wants a personal relationship with me. This understanding of God's nature has impacted my life in a lot of ways. It gives me a feeling of comfort and security, and I know that I'm not alone in this world and that I have a loving father who watches over me. It has also encouraged me to seek a deeper relationship with God, and I know that he wants me to know him completely. I know God is always by my side, even though he is in heaven. It's important to me to know that and keep that in my mind and my heart. I know God should be worshipped and glorified in my life because of all that he's done for me. It gives me personal relief that should be worldwide for all us believers, the knowledge that God is always with us. Because I know he's by my side, I can do anything. I can go through any hardship and struggle. God provides for me and keeps me safe. The Lord's Prayer has had a huge impact on my life and the relationship with church. It has reminded me of God's nature as a loving father, a provider, and a protector.
Amen. Summary, I think, is the first confirmand that I've almost traumatized and drove out of the church by a last-minute acolyting duty. No, what a blessing to have a family here serving in our armed forces and to be able to spend time in the sacrament and to also on the year of graduation from high school to also have a time of accomplishment, but not so much accomplishment, the time of joy in the gifts and identity of who you are in Jesus Christ. And so the first senior graduating in high school to come be confirmed here while I've been here, and what a joy. I'm so sad that you guys are about to be moving, but we'll invite your family forward a little bit later. I'd like to invite everyone to pray with me as we lift up our prayers in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit to a God who has an open ear. God, our Father in heaven, look with mercy on us, your needy children on earth, and grant us grace that your holy name be hallowed by us and all the world through the pure and true teaching of your word and the fervent love shown forth in our lives. Graciously turn from us all false doctrine and evil living, whereby your precious name is blasphemed and profaned. Lord, in your mercy, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. May your kingdom come to us and expand. Bring all transgressors and those who are blinded and bound in the devil's kingdom to know Jesus, your Son, by faith, that the number of Christians may be increased. Lord, in your mercy, strengthen us by your Spirit, according to your will, both in life and in death, in the midst of both good and evil things, that our own wills may be crucified daily and sacrificed to your good and gracious will. Into your merciful hands, for healing, for care and strength, we commend new today in our prayers together, Glenn, and Tim, and Shanna, those whom we additionally name in our hearts. And all who are in need, praying for them at all times, thy will be done. Lord, in your mercy, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Grant us our daily bread. Preserve us from greed and selfish cares. And help us trust in you to provide for all our needs. Lord, in your mercy, forgive us our sins as we also forgive those who sin against us, so that our hearts may be at peace and may rejoice in a good conscience before you, that no sin may ever frighten or alarm us. Lord, in your mercy, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, O Lord, but help us by your Spirit to subdue our flesh, to turn from the world and its ways, and to overcome the devil with all his wiles. Lord, in your mercy, lead us not into temptation. And lastly, O Heavenly Father, deliver us from all evil of both body and soul, now and forever. Lord, in your mercy, deliver us from evil. We trust, O Lord, in your great mercy to heal, to hear, and answer us through Jesus Christ our Lord. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. I'd like to invite our confirmants to come forward. beloved in the Lord. Our Lord Jesus Christ said to his apostles, "All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all the things I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always to the very end of the age." You have been baptized and catechized in the Christian faith. Jesus' will has been done to this point in your life. And so now, as we remember Jesus' words also, saying, "Whoever confesses me before men, I will also confess before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I will also deny before my Father who is in heaven." With those words in our ears, you who, having learned of Christ and his glorious gifts, his wonderful will and mission in your life, lift up your hearts. Be glad. Be glad, therefore, to the God of all grace, and joyfully give answer to what I now ask you in the name of the Lord. Do you this day, in the presence of God and of this congregation, acknowledge the gifts that God gave you in your baptism?
Yes, I do.
Do you renounce the devil?
Yes, I renounce him.
Do you renounce all his works?
Yes, I renounce them.
Do you renounce all his ways?
Yes, I renounce them.
Do you believe in God the Father Almighty?
Yes, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord?
Yes, I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
Yes.
Yes, I believe in the Holy Spirit,
the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Do you hold all prophetic and apostolic scriptures to be the inspired word of God?
I do.
Do you confess the doctrine of the Evangelical Lutheran Church drawn from the scriptures as you have learned it, to know it, as you have learned to know it from the Small Catechism, to be faithful and true?
I do.
Do you intend to hear the word of God and receive the Lord's Supper faithfully?
I do, by the grace of God.
Do you intend to live according to the word of God and in faith, word, and deed remain true to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, even to death?
I do, by the grace of God.
Do you intend to continue steadfast in this confession and church and to suffer all, even death, rather than fall away from it?
I do, by the grace of God.
We rejoice with thankful hearts that you have been baptized and have received the teaching of the Lord. You have confessed the faith and have been absolved of all of your sins. As you continue to hear the Lord's word and receive his blessed sacrament, he who has begun a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. I invite you to kneel. Summer Pettigrew, the Almighty God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given you the new birth of water and of the Spirit, and has forgiven you all of your sins, strengthen you with his grace to life everlasting. Amen. Summer, receive this word of Holy Scripture to be your confirmation verse for ongoing strength and joy in the Lord. From Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. For by grace you have been saved through faith. This is not your own doing, it is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. Rejoice. Zoey Perea, the Almighty God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given you the new birth of water and of the Spirit, and has forgiven you all of your sins, strengthen you with his grace to everlasting life. Amen. Zoey, receive this word of Holy Scripture to be your confirmation verse for ongoing strength and joy in the Lord. It's John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Mia Barrientos. The Almighty God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given you the new birth of water and of the Spirit, and has forgiven you all your sins, strengthen you with his grace to life everlasting. Amen. Mia, receive this word of Holy Scripture as your confirmation verse for ongoing strength and joy in the Lord. Romans 1, verse 16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes. We pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you for your great goodness in bringing these, your daughters, to the knowledge of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and enabling them both with the heart to believe and with the mouth to confess his saving name. Grant that bringing forth the fruits of faith, they may continue steadfast and victorious to the day when all who have fought the good fight of faith shall receive the crown of righteousness. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please stand and face the congregation. Can we rejoice together with applause at the wonderful gifts these are to us and God is to them. This is Zoey. Receive these study Bibles to be a light, God's light of Holy Scripture to you as you explore, as you learn, as you grow, as you walk with your Lord. Here's this. Zoey. And Mia. The peace of the Lord be with you. Amen. Amen. Once again, can we rejoice together in our way? Please applause. Thank you so much. You can return to your seats. And we will continue with our service of the Holy Sacrament in our holy bulletin, in our bulletin for today. Please stand on page 9 at the bottom. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord our God, King of all creation. For you have had mercy on us and given your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Grant us your Spirit, gracious Father, that we may give heed to the testament of your Son in true faith, and above all firmly take to heart the words with which Christ gives to us his body and blood for our forgiveness. By your grace, lead us to remember and give thanks for the boundless love which he manifested to us, when by pouring out his precious blood he saved us from your righteous wrath and from sin, death, and hell. Grant that we may receive the bread and wine, that is, his body and blood, as a gift, guarantee, and pledge of his salvation. Graciously receive our prayers. Deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, at his command and with his own words, we receive his testament. You may be seated. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way, also after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." We sing together with saints and angels, archangels, and each other, all the company of heaven, "Holy, holy, holy.
Holy, 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 all the saints in glory, fill the temple with their song around your golden throne. Holy, 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 with them we adore you, God in three persons, all in Christ as one."
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen.
Amen. The Lamb, O Father, bears the sacrifice, faith sees, believes. God will provide the Lamb of Christ. Worthy is the Lamb whose death makes me his own. The Lamb is reigning on his throne. The Lamb, as wayward sheep their shepherd kills, so still his will on our behalf the law to fill. Worthy is the Lamb whose death makes me his own. The Lamb is reigning on his throne.
His eyes, he dies.
Thank you.
Thank you. 537.
Body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you, body and soul, into life everlasting. Depart in peace. I'd like to invite Summer and all your family, the Meyer family, to come forward. One of the things that's an annual joy of ours is to offer a special blessing for our youth who graduate from high school in summer. The coming Saturday is graduation day. All the classes are done, the grades are earned, and so we're so thrilled for you. Also, this is the last Sunday that you and your family will be here in El Paso, although we continue in the communion that is Jesus Christ. And so we want to offer a prayer for your whole family. But first, hear this proverb, proverb number 3. Blessed is the one who finds wisdom, and the one who gets understanding. For the gain from her is better than gain from silver, and her profit better than gold. Wisdom is more precious than jewels, and nothing you desire can compare with her. Long life is in her right hand. In her left hand are riches and honor. Wisdom's ways are ways of pleasantness, and all her paths are peace. She is a tree of life to those who lay hold of her. Those who hold her fast are called blessed. The Lord, by wisdom, founded the earth. By understanding, he established the heavens. By his knowledge, the deeps broke open, and the clouds dropped down the dew. My child, do not lose sight of these. Keep sound wisdom and discretion, and they will be life for your soul and adornment for your neck. Then you will walk on your way securely, and your foot will not stumble. Can you come forward, Summer? Heavenly Father, we thank you for graciously bringing Summer to this point in her formal education. For all the efforts of her parents and teachers through these years, we praise you. We ask wisdom and guidance for Summer as she makes decisions about her life that will have implications for years to come. Give her a rich measure of your spirit as fields of study and opportunities for employment become available. Help her to accurately assess the gifts and abilities you have given, and bless the choices that she makes. May she ever grow closer to you in faith, and with her life and vocations, honor the name of your only Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Praise God for Summer, everybody, and all her teachers. Here, you can keep copies of this for your scrapbook. Can we pray? Lord Heavenly Father, we thank you for all who serve our nation and serve our communities in defense against all that would be evil and that would seek to take and destroy and abuse, Lord. Thank you for all who serve in our military, and we thank you for Joseph and all his family, the service that he's been rendering all these years and that he still is and will be in the coming years. Lord, bless them. Grant them safety and success in their work. Lord, watch over them as they travel. Lord, we thank you for the unity that you give to us all in your grace and in your very body, the body of Christ, that unites us even when geography would separate us. Lord, bless them, strengthen them, guide them, be their peace now and always. We thank and praise you for them. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much for being part of our lives, and God go with you. Can we have a round of applause for them? I believe it is hymn 806. I invite you all to stand, and we can sing together our praises to God, our thanksgiving to God. You can return to your seats. Thank you. Thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ His Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ His Son. The weak say I am strong, let the poor say I am rich, because of what the Lord has done for us. And now let the weak say I am strong, let the poor say I am rich, because of what the Lord has done for us. Give thanks, give thanks. We do give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you sent your Son to make peace with us by the blood of his cross. As we have feasted upon his body and blood for our forgiveness and peace, strengthen us to live lives of peace here on earth through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. Amen. We remain standing and sing hymn 837.
Lift high the cross, the love of Christ proclaim, till all the world the Lord his sacred name. Come, Christians, follow where our death been trod, our name victorious, Christ the Son of God. Lift high the cross, the love of Christ proclaim, till all the world adore his sacred name. Let all the praise of this earth
the cross, the love of Christ proclaim, till all the world adore his sacred name. All you white soldiers of the crucified, bear on their brows the seal of him who died. Lift high the cross, the love of Christ proclaim, till all the world adore his sacred name. Lord, once lifted on the glorious tree, as thou hast promised, draw us all to thee. Lift high the cross, the love of Christ proclaim, till all the world adore his sacred name. Let every race and every language tell of him who saves our life, death, and hell. Lift high the cross, the love of Christ proclaim, till all the world adore his sacred name. So shall our song of triumph ever be, praise to the crucified for victory. Lift high the cross, the love of Christ proclaim, till all the world adore his sacred name.
So I'd encourage everyone to look at the announcements in the back of the bulletin. Just a couple of points to highlight. The first is that you're all welcome to the cake and punch reception following the service here in our fellowship hall in honor of our confirmands and to celebrate this day. Also, Tuesday, June 6th, so this coming Tuesday, we're going to have Scott Mauser from the Alpha Omega Institute, who's going to provide a discussion of dinosaurs in the Bible. So you can come early for pizza at 6 p.m., and then the presentation will begin at 7 p.m., and I understand there's prizes available as well.
Just a comment on that, and that's an attempt Bible study. It normally starts at 7:30. We're going to do this instead. So come for pizza at 6, and we're going to stay on for the presentation.
Are there any announcements for today?
We are very happy to announce Kathy and Brandon are engaged.
My announcement, among others, is that Trinity Sunday, 58 years ago, this Sunday, Marilyn and I were married right here. And that applause, Marilyn, is your wedding anniversary present for this year. Another. Zion is so full of wonderful surprises, and they just keep coming and coming, and that's why I come every Sunday. I can't wait to see what the Lord has in store this day. And this day we have a visitor. His name is Andrew Cole, and he's wearing one of the ugliest t-shirts you will ever see. Andrew, stand up if you would, please. The shirt says Concordia Seminary, St. Louis, Missouri. And God willing, in the next weeks, Andrew is going to enter the seminary pursuing the gift of pastoral ministry. And I wanted you all to know that. He is visiting us this Sunday. And Andrew, we're going to keep you in our prayers right through ordination day and into the next. See? So good to have you. Keep you in our prayers. But that's still not the announcement. Because I wanted you all to know next Sunday, the Lutheran Church, Missouri Synod, and Friends congregations of the El Paso area will celebrate and praise God for over 30 years of the ministry of Stevens Folks. Just stand up a second. It's going to happen out at Isleta Lutheran Mission, but they have been pastors, missionaries, caretakers, lovers of God's people at Isleta for over 30 years.
Over 40.
And our congregations and this city is blessed by these two people. Thank you. And that's still not the announcement. The announcement is, at the end of these announcements, I'd like you all to stay so that Stephen can help Marilyn and I renew our wedding vows. We should be through 2 o'clock. I say 2:50. No, the last one is Bible study on Sunday mornings throughout this summer, the next 3 months. One of the great gifts, obviously, that God has given through His Word is the Book of Psalms, all 150 of them. And we're learning, and Pastor Stephen, with his musical gifts, is teaching us how to chant the Psalms the way the Psalms, or very like the Psalms, that we sang as God's people over 3,000 years ago. And many of us have never chanted the Psalms, and so we're in the process of learning. But it is to us in our spiritual lives one of God's great gifts. If you're not used to coming on Sunday morning for Bible study, I would suggest that maybe what you want to do this summer is say thank you to God for another gift. This building is 100 years old this year. And God's people have worshiped and served and been comforted and given us safety in this place for 100 years. So if you are a member of the congregation, or if you're not, or if you'd like to become one, join us at 9:15 each Sunday morning, or those Sunday mornings you can, to say thank you to God for this sanctuary, this church, His church throughout the world, and learn to sing the great hymns out of the hymnal of Christ's church, the Psalms. It's 9:15 next Sunday, as you can. You're going to come into a gift at the end of this summer, I guarantee you, as together we sing the Psalms together, and that really is my last announcement.
And after he was retired, Zion called and said, were struggling with no pastor. And so we said, it's time to move to the sunshine. Now, he grew up in northern Minnesota, and he didn't know what it was like to live in all this sunshine. I want you to know now this is his favorite place. He's lived all over the country.
No other announcements?
cake.
Wish you all a great afternoon and a great week. And there is cake and punch out here for everyone after the complete.